The JFK 35 podcast is made possible through generous support from the Blanche and Irving Laurie Foundation.
Kennedy loved the Outer Cape and the beaches and the nearshore environment, and sailing around it. And he and many others recognized that that was starting to slip away. And if they didn't do something back in the 50s and 60s, as the idea was forming and ultimately was approved in 61, but that might be lost forever.
The Cape Cod National Seashore is one of three protected coastlines established by President John F. Kennedy. Today, we'll look at the history and legacy left behind from the decision to protect 40 miles of coastline in southeastern Massachusetts. We'll also revisit our interview with President Kennedy's granddaughter, Tatiana Slossberg, and her book about the everyday decisions we make that affect our environment. That's next on this special Earth Day episode of JFK 35.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country.
Hello, I'm Matt Porter, and on this Earth Day episode of JFK 35, we will look at one of the decisions President John F. Kennedy made to protect our nation's coastlines. In 1956, 4 years before Kennedy took office, the National Park Service issued a report called Our Vanishing Shorelines. The report warned without action by the federal government to curtail private development, much of the country's seashores would be inaccessible for public use. The report recommended the federal government use its authority to acquire portions of the country's shorelines in the interest of public use before these natural coastlines would be gobbled up by private developers. While the Eisenhower administration opposed the report's recommendation to have the federal government acquire the land, President Kennedy took up the cause. Today, there are 10 national seashores in the United States, and three of them were established by President Kennedy: Port Reyes in California, Padre Island in Texas, and Cape Cod in the president's home state of Massachusetts. And I'm privileged to be joined by Brian Kallstrom, superintendent of the Cape Cod National Seashore. Brian, thanks for joining me.
It's a pleasure to be here, Matt. Looking forward to our conversation about Kennedy and his role at the Cape Cod National Seashore, the home of the Wampanoag people, who are the people of the First Light.
We are excited to have you. So to begin right now, can you tell us about the history behind the decision to make the Cape Cod beaches a national seashore?
Yeah, it's pretty fascinating history. Back in the 50s, many people were growing concerned about development starting to encroach on the Outer Cape. And John Fitzgerald Kennedy, as a senator at that time and having had a home in Hyannis, was very interested in helping to preserve the Outer Cape and its ambience, and helped with some of the legislation as he was in his role as a U.S. senator. And then when he became president, it actually became a national seashore, the first one under his signature, along with two other national seashores, Point Reyes out in California near San Francisco, and Padre Island down in, on the Gulf Shores of Texas. And Cape Cod really is a unique model in terms of National Park Service sites, in that it was the first one that was carved out of six towns that were already developed. So it was done in a highly collaborative manner, and it helped to preserve the ambience of the Outer Cape, which is a very unique thing to be defined as part of the enabling legislation for any unit of the national park system. One of the things Kennedy said, I think, is very applicable here, and it's national parks and reserves are an integral aspect of intelligent use of natural resources. It is the course of wisdom to set aside an ample portion of our natural resources as national parks and reserves, thus ensuring that future generations may know the majesty of the earth as we know it today.
Now, you mentioned in your opening that it's also the land of the Mashpee or the Wampanoags, the Native Americans who were here before any yes. colonists came here. Could you want to tell me a little bit about that history?
It's a very rich history going back at least 9,000 years. You know, they were on the land and respected it and were excellent stewards of it. Throughout that entire history, there are many archaeological sites and sites that are still of great significance to the Wampanoag people throughout Cape Cod National Seashore. We interpret what their presence was and where they were at our visitor center, at the Fort Hill Nature Trails. We have one of their sharpening stones that they use to sharpen tools and weapons and hunting gear for thousands of years that we share with visitors and are happy to interact with them. And in non-COVID times, we have an annual Wampanoag Native American Festival in June. We hope to have that coming back in summer 22.
I think that America's history, you know, is not quite perfect when it comes to Native American relations. Has that grown since the seashore was made? And, like, you know, especially with the significance now that the Secretary of Interior for the first time is a Native American origin, have you guys grown in that relationship since this started?
Oh, yeah. I think we've got a really strong relationship with the Wampanoag people, both the Aquinna and the Mashpee tribes, and interact with them, with their tribal historic preservation officers and with their tribal councils and with their youth. We've had interactions with our fire program out here on Cape Cod. We've also working to have, we hope, COVID allowing, 4 Wampanoag tribal members as interns for science and communications and education working with us this summer.
You mentioned that this was done during President Kennedy's tenure as president. What was the situation along beaches, as far as development? You mentioned that people were concerned about overdevelopment. What was the situation there, and how had Kennedy's decision to protect Cape Cod affected the coastline?
If you look around the coastline of Massachusetts and other areas along the Atlantic, much of it is developed. And Kennedy loved the Outer Cape and the beaches and the nearshore environment, and sailing around it. And he and many others recognized that that was starting to slip away. And if they didn't do something back in the 50s and 60s, as the idea was forming and ultimately was approved in 61, that might be lost forever. So they knew that it was a point in time where it needed to be preserved. And if it wasn't done, it would never be available again. And that ambience and that natural environment and the wildness of the Outer Cape would slip away to development and private interests. And they wanted to make sure that it was maintained for public enjoyment as a national seashore.
And, you know, the Cape in Massachusetts is obviously a very unique landmass. What makes it unique as far as the animals and plants that call the area home?
There's a lot in that question, Matt. Let me unwrap it a little
bit. Fine.
I'll start with the glacial process that established the Cape. Basically, the Cape is part of a moraine deposit of gravel and numerous sized rocks and sand from the lobes of glaciation. And there were a couple of different campaigns that created it, but what the end result is that we have now is what's considered by many to be the longest glaciated peninsula in the world. We have 40 miles of uninterrupted coastline with wild coastal geomorphological processes occurring on a daily basis that at times can be quite spectacular. Annual shoreline erosion on the Outer Cape, we know from over a century's worth of very intense scientific measurement, is about 3 feet, but in any one storm event, that can instantly be 60 feet or more. And those are erosion hotspots that happen and happen on a regular basis that aren't necessarily random. And with that rich history of data that we have in the transects along the entire coastline, we understand how the sand is moving and how the erosion is occurring fairly well. And that has created a unique environment for a whole host of animal species. At the seashore, we've got over 570 species of animals that occupy the marine environment, the nearshore environment, the coastal dune environment, the heathlands, then the pitch pine forest, the ponds, the salt marshes, and the upland forest. So it's a very rich, ecologically diverse area that we're here to help preserve as well. And we have a lot of long-term ecological monitoring effort going on in and around all of those different environments.
What would happen to the rest of the state if the state lost this ecosystem?
Well, from a state perspective and specifically for Cape Cod, Greater Cape Cod, the seashore really serves as a tourist destination and a vacation wonderland. And it's also a very critical piece of the local economy. You know, we attract around 4 million visitors a year. Last year it was 4.1 million. And it really is an economic engine from tourism that fuels a lot of what happens on the Cape. And we're happy to be a part of that. And I think if the seashore were to go away, that would change forever. You know, the natural environment and the fact that we have over 40 miles of natural beaches, like the background behind me here at Coast Guard, is what draws people to the Cape, is to experience that, to immerse themselves in that wildness, to have that experience on the beach, on the ocean, where they can recreate, enjoy themselves, reconnect with nature. A lot of different things you can do for that. Beach combing, walking on the beach, fishing, the different water sports. There's also a lot of experiences with hiking and kayaking and paddle sports. Bicycling is another huge activity in the seashore. Some of the first bicycle trails in the National Park Service are right here at Cape Cod National Seashore.
You know, we think about the pictures that come every season of the whales sort of returning to the Cape area. Is the National Seashore a big reason why those animals continue to be able to come back and enjoy the waters of the area?
We definitely contribute to the water quality, though that's overall, it's a pretty small portion in terms of the landmass the seashore has, with about 44,000 acres. Mm-hmm. But whale watching and interpreting the return of the whales to Cape Cod Bay with the right whales as they're coming in right now, and the humpbacks as they return through the summer, we definitely help to interpret why the whales are here, how important they are to the marine ecosystems, what their migration patterns are. And it's pretty cool. I mean, you can see whales and observe whales from the shore of Cape Cod, specifically out at Race Point Beach, and then also at Herring Cove near Provincetown.
Now, there are two sort of events happening right now on the planet, one long-term, one short-term, that I assume is affecting you at the Cape Cod Seashore. The short-term one being the pandemic. We hear all over the country that the lack of people and places have sort of created sort of a renaissance for animals coming back to places they haven't seen in forever. What has that been like at the Cape Cod National Seashore?
We haven't seen so much of that. Last summer, we had 4.1 million visitors, which was actually up slightly from the previous year.
Okay.
I think we're within, you know, a reasonable drive from Boston, and all of our beaches have remained open throughout the entire pandemic ordeal as an opportunity for folks to come out and enjoy and reconnect. And, you know, that's been an honor to be able to provide that kind of a experience for people through this pandemic, just to get a break from all the constraints and stress that creates.
That's great. And I think we talked about, I took advantage of that last summer as well.
Yeah. You know, I manage the seashore, but I play there too.
The long-term issue going on is obviously climate change, and the changes in the environment. How have you seen that effect? Have there been effects at the seashore?
Yeah, the climate change is undeniably affecting the seashore. You know, we're seeing some temperature shifts in our ponds and changes in terms of how the algae bloom, and some of that is toxic that we watch closely with our partners with the states and the towns. We have some long-term ecological monitoring stations within the seashore. We have been monitoring wave energy that's coming into the seashore and the waves that come in, and we know that the intensity of the overall wave energy that the seashore is experiencing is increasing a little bit, because as sea level rise continues, there are many parts of it that continue to be understood further. And we do know that more wave energy from the big massive storm systems now clears the Georges Bank. And that means the next thing that it encounters is Cape Cod. So from a long-term perspective, we know that's changing the rate of erosion in some areas with greater intensity, but we're still learning more about that every day. We don't have any conclusive information on that necessarily, but we are planning for and doing things in response to sea level rise and what the models show, so that we continue to provide incredible access to our beaches. We've developed an adaptive model where we retreat and rebuild those facilities, and we do it in a sustainable fashion so that they can in fact be relocated, so we're not continually rebuilding the entire structures.
Are you worried if the country and the world doesn't act that the Cape Cod National Seashore could be much smaller 50 years from now?
You know, it's a coastal environment. It's forever shrinking. That's a fact. Georges Bank used to be a terrestrial environment. That's kind of this is geologic timescale we're talking of. Cape Cod's next. As sea level rises, it is a concern. It's part of the natural processes. And it's absolutely a concern for us. We know the rate of change in terms of what's happening with our climate is unprecedented. There's a great body of scientific evidence that supports that. We work closely with the National Park Service Climate Change Response Program that's national, that helps us to understand our vulnerability. And we make decisions based on that science. That's part of my job, is to be a responsible steward and to set an example for how that can be done in the most compatible way possible, while taking into account how we responsibly spend the taxpayers' dollars to maintain those access and all those assets that are at greater risk.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about people coming to enjoy the Capes, to enjoy its beaches, but there's a large education component to the National Park Service.
Absolutely.
What do you try to teach people, young, old, middle-aged, as they come into your education programs, whether it's taking a walking tour or, listening to a National Park Ranger talk?
Our goal is to provide information to our visitors through sharing sound science and information, to provide hopefully a little bit of inspiration or connection or a little bit of fuel to stimulate their curiosity and maybe their intellectual pursuits. And we do that in a number of different ways. We kind of have a menu, if you will, of services that we provide through social media, through our ranger talks, through our educational programs. We've had interaction with several generations of fourth graders on the seashore and high school students, and they come back to us and just share how enriching those experiences were. We've provided ranger programs that interpret tidal marshes, the Atlantic White Cedar Swamp, the other different environments throughout the seashore. It's really a moving experience to be out there with school-age kids and seeing the rangers do their work through interpretation to help them better understand the natural world we live in and to make a personal connection to it.
This episode will air on Earth Day, a day Yes. set aside to reflect on preserving the environment and being good stewards. What would you say is the most important, or some of the most important things to reflect this Earth Day?
This Earth Day is one that's very different given the state of the world coming through a global pandemic. And I think it's a kind of a unique opportunity for people to really consider how fortunate we are living in the United States to have resources available to us, such as Cape Cod National Seashore, where you can go out and experience the earth and all it has to offer on its own terms. And there are so many things you can do to be a responsible steward as a citizen of the United States, as a responsible steward for Cape Cod National Seashore. We need you to recognize that the seashore is yours. It exists because it was created through the actions of President Kennedy and his brother Ted Kennedy, and so many carrying it forward, and the work that's happening through restoration projects like the Herring River. Go out, choose a way to, on your own terms, that you can connect. If you want to go pick up some trash along the beach on your own, do so. If you want to go for a nature hike, do that. Get out and enjoy the seashore. It's yours to enjoy. It's something that is an intrinsically American value that, as many consider, our best idea that we've given to the world. And let's make sure it's going to be there so we can continue giving these best examples of what America has to offer. And, you know, if I can close this out, I'd like to offer one more thing that is very poignant that is in our visitor center at Salt Pond in Eastham that President Kennedy said. And that's, you know, it's a popular quote, but it's one so important and relevant to the seashore. And that is, we are tied to the ocean. And when we go back to the sea, we are going back from whence we came. John F. Kennedy.
I think that's an amazing final thought. Do you believe, that we have lived up to those values of protecting the ocean?
I think we're doing better. You know, life's a journey. You learn from the past, apply those lessons to the future, and hope that you're making a difference along the way. And the ocean is something that we're just beginning to really truly understand. And it's amazing to see truly how little marine debris accumulates on Cape Cod compared to other areas around the country that I've seen. And people are growing to respect it. We're developing more collaborative relationships with all the different interests that utilize the ocean. And the seashore is there to help be a steward for that and for the nearshore environment. And we're going to continually work to try and do our best at that. We've come a long way. We got a long way to go.
Well, Brian, thank you so much for taking the time. I really look forward to visiting the seashore again this summer.
We look forward to having you, Matt. Make sure to tell all your friends about us. And seashore is yours to enjoy. Come on out and check it.
Since the 1960s, we've become more aware of humanity's effects on the environment, some of it disastrous and long-lasting. The terms climate change and global warming were not part of the lexicon in Kennedy's administration, but are inescapable today. In December 2019, we spoke with Tatiana Sloshberg, JFK's granddaughter, who wrote a book about how our everyday decisions can have drastic impacts on the environment. Here's that interview again now. And joining me now is Tatiana Sloshberg, who also took a holistic look at the climate crisis in her new book, Inconspicuous Consumption: The Environmental Impact You Don't Know You Have. In addition to being President Kennedy's granddaughter, Tatiana is an accomplished journalist who wrote about climate change and the environment for the New York Times. She has also been a contributor to The Atlantic and Bloomberg View. Tatiana, thank you for joining me today.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right, so I'm going to get right to the question. The first one I want to ask is, what made you decide to write this book, particularly at this moment in time?
Well, I wanted to write the book because I felt I was a science and climate reporter at the New York Times, and I felt like there was a lot that was missing from the kind of larger journalistic coverage of climate change, and that was really the scale and the context that might make this issue more relevant and relatable for readers, because I think so often the scale of it hasn't made sense. You know, we have on the one hand plastic bottles, and on the other hand a complete transformation of the electricity grid in less than 10 years. And it felt to me like, you know, having that size of a scale made this issue seem so abstract and distant, and it already can feel so kind of far away in space and time. And so I wanted to try to ground it in the daily lives of readers and also help them kind of understand why this issue is so complicated and difficult to solve.
Yeah, and I really got that reading the book. In fact, one of the first things that you talked about, you mentioned the plastic straw debate, you know, whether or not, you know, we should be getting rid of plastic straws. And you do mention that they are a problem, but sort of plastic straws are just the tip of the iceberg. You want to tell me a little bit about what you learned about from that debate?
Yeah, the tip of the slowly melting iceberg. you know, I think that the plastic, you know, most of us don't need to use straws. And so, of course, it's always good to be thinking about how we can lessen our consumption and particularly our use of plastic, which is, you know, made from oil. But, you know, basically, if, you know, even if the highest estimates of plastic straws are on beaches and in oceans around the world, it's about 0.03% of all ocean plastic. And, you know, about between 8 and 13 million tons of plastic get into the ocean every year. Most of it is a little less than half is fishing equipment. And so I think it's my concern about it is that it might let people feel like, okay, well, I got rid of my plastic straw, therefore I can, you know, take a taxi. And I also think, you know, then we're thinking, oh, I didn't take a plastic straw, but what about the, you know, the to-go lid and the cup that's lined with plastic and the creamer pod and the stirrer and all these other things. And I think it, you know, I would like to see an emphasis more on kind of our to-go and convenience culture rather than just patting ourselves on the back about our straws.
Right. And, you know, it's a bigger problem as you continue to talk about one of these things about things that we encounter in our daily life that I thought kind of struck me was you talked about Netflix. You know, I like to go home and watch my Parks and Recreation nonstop for a couple hours. But Netflix, you know, invisibly is polluting itself because mm-hmm. of the internet and data centers. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, so that was really interesting for me to learn about just because I think like most people, I hadn't thought a lot about the physical infrastructure of the internet, but it is an enormous physical system that's, you know, made up of cables and routers and modems all over the world, but also, you know, in order to send and receive information, which we're doing all the time, it needs to be on. And so to be on, it needs to be powered by electricity. And, you know, depending on where the data is stored that you're accessing at a particular moment in time, it could be powered by fossil fuels. And, you know, especially since a lot of what people can read about in the book, which is that the history of the internet has kind of dictated that a lot of the infrastructure is in Northern Virginia, which is a place that runs on a lot of fossil fuels. And so even if, you know, a data center might be powered by renewable energy, if it's nighttime or it's not windy, you know, they're going to resort to these dirtier backup fuels, which are fossil fuels. And also all of these data centers, in order to make sure that they are running, you know, able to run all the time, that they don't have these service interruptions, they all have diesel generators to back it up. So I think it was a really powerful example for me of how we are all, you know, whether we know it or not, we're all kind of participating in this system. You know, I can be sitting in New York or in Boston and watching Parks and Recreation, and I'm creating the demand for fossil fuels to be burned in Virginia. And I think it was just a really, again, powerful example to me of how we're all kind of implicated in the system, and therefore we're all responsible for figuring it out. But, you know, I think an important message that I try to get across in the book is that, yes, you know, the things that we do every day and all of our stuff connects to this crisis of climate change, but, you know, that's not to say that we are individually, you know, that we should feel individually guilty for climate change. I don't think we should feel individually guilty because I think that that narrative of personal responsibility is destructive because it lets those who are actually responsible off the hook. But I do think we're collectively responsible for building a better world and creating better systems.
You know, one of the chapters, one of the sections you chose to talk about was fashion, mm-hmm. Which I found really interesting. Why did you want to talk about the fashion industry when it comes to climate change and environmentalism?
Yeah, I think, you know, similarly with the internet, it's something that doesn't immediately come to mind. You know, the two other sections in the book are about food and fuel, which I think are more intuitive and something that people have thought a lot about and talked a lot about when it comes to climate change, but the internet and fashion in particular haven't come up as much. But fashion, I mean, it's an industry that touches animal agriculture, plant agriculture, petrochemicals, mining, forestry, shipping. It's, you know, it's kind of the engine of globalization in the same way that it was the engine of the Industrial Revolution, you know, producing textiles. It's an enormous industry that, you know, millions and millions of people work in all over the world, and all of us interact with the system. And it is, I think we've kind of been complacent about the environmental impacts in a way that we're not so much with things like food. And I think it's, you know, we just wear our clothes, we don't eat them. So we don't think quite as much about how they're made, but it's an incredibly polluting industry and incredibly energy intensive. And, you know, there are all kinds of different labor violations and things like that all over the world. But I wanted to kind of illustrate some of the different environmental impacts of various materials, whether it was, you know, the water used to grow cotton or how trees are cut down to make viscose rayon and things like that.
Right. And you talk a little bit about this fast fashion, which has maybe made things a little worse.
Yep. so that's companies like I think probably most people are familiar with, like Zara or H&M, which kind of are cheap versions of kind of designer clothing. And they're really poorly made. They kind of replenish their stock like every 2 weeks or so. So there's just constantly new clothes that are coming in that people are buying because they seem cheap and they're sort of fashionable, but they fall apart pretty readily. And also they go out of style pretty quickly. So it's an enormous amount of energy and resources being used to create this stuff that, you know, the average clothing is worn 7 times before it's thrown away. So we're really spending a lot of energy and resources and money on clothes that that we don't even keep. And I think, you know, there's a sense that these clothes are really cheap, and so therefore, you know, it's easy to buy them. But I think, you know, they're cheap because no one really pays for the ultimate cost of producing them, whether that's the energy or the resources or the water pollution or, you know, the people whose health are affected by producing these clothes. And so, you know, we think it's cheap because no one actually pays for the cost, you know, or the companies that make these clothes don't pay for the cost, but we pay it for it in terms of things like ecosystem health and clean water and healthcare costs and things like that.
You know, one of the other industries I want to briefly touch on is the food industry. Mm-hmm. You talk a lot about when you tried to go through the grocery store yourself and be more sustainable, that was not easy. Tell me about that experience.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think having learned all the things that I've learned in writing this book, it can be paralyzing to go to the grocery store. Just because in general, in all these different areas, it's really difficult as a consumer to kind of know what is the right decision to make and what's the more sustainable thing to do. And that's because, you know, the companies that produce these, our food or our clothes, there's really not a lot of transparency about where things come from and how they're made. And so, you know, I think with food, generally speaking, a lot of the things that we've heard are true, you know, whether it's kind of eating red meat and, you know, or just eating less animal products in general, that is better for the environment. But that's you know, and it's partly because of the emissions from just raising livestock, but it's also because of this major industrial system that's kind of opaque to us as consumers as we're, you know, trying to figure out what to eat.
And it's just a boggle of choices and trying to figure things out. The last question I want to touch on, you know, we're here in John F. Kennedy Library. President Kennedy had a deep appreciation for the natural world. He established 3 national seashores to protect coastlines and oceans, promoted a youth conservation corps. Was there anything from your grandfather, President Kennedy, that his legacy on the environment that you've sort of been influenced by?
Well, I think, you know, a lot of the work that he did in terms of inspiring Americans and asking people to get involved, you know, I think we see that in the environmental movement that came up in the later in the 60s after his death. But I think, you know, his call to service really resonated with that generation and the laws and regulations that cleaned up our air and water and protected our natural resources are, you know, a result of that civic action. I also think, you know, I was reading about all the work that the White House did, his administration did, to support the work of Rachel Carson, who wrote Silent Spring, which was kind of the first a book that called attention to the dangers of pesticides in terms of birds and all other kinds of wildlife. And so, you know, reading about that and how important it was to his administration and to him to support scientists. And, you know, we're seeing even today that the Trump administration is not letting scientists use things like the health effects of air pollution in creating their regulations. So, you know, to me, that was so important and inspiring and a really crucial for the government to take science into account when it's making decisions about our health and the environment.
Well said. Tatiana, thank you so much for joining us and thank you for writing the book.
Thank you for having me.
On this 51st Earth Day, we can reflect that while humans have created significant environmental problems, we can also be the solution. In 1960, President Kennedy called for a moonshot to spur new innovations to put a man on the moon. Today, we have to think about the Earthshots, the new technologies and processes that will help reverse or minimize the effects of climate change. In the last 51 years since the first Earth Day, we have made some progress. Scientists announced just last year that the record-breaking hole in the ozone layer that drew concern in the 1980s and 90s has finally closed. A change that happened because we, as global citizens, answered the call to solve a global problem. So today, I'll close our episode with a few words from Kennedy himself as he closed out his first inaugural address.
Finally, whether you are citizens of America or citizens of the world, ask of us here the same high standards of strength and sacrifice which we ask of you. With a good conscience, our only sure reward, with history the final judge of our deeds, let us go forth to lead the land we love, asking his blessing and his help, but knowing that here on earth, God's work must truly be our own.
Thanks for listening to this week's episode of JFK 35. Visit our podcast page at jfklibrary.org/JFK35, where we'll have more information on topics mentioned in this episode. If you have questions or story ideas, email us at jfk35pod@jfklfoundation.org or tweet at us at JFK Library using the hashtag JFK35. If you liked what you heard today, please consider subscribing to our podcast or leaving us a review wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening and have a great week.